The book of Job, chapter 37, verse 22. Fair weather cometh out of the north, with the Most High is terrible majesty. Touching the Almighty, we cannot find him out. All right, I want to give all praises, honor, and glory to Yahawah, Bahasham, Yahawashi, Bahasham, Rahakwadash. Yahawah is the true name of the Heavenly Father in the Holy Tongue. Yahawashi is the true name of the King and Savior of Israel. And Rahakwadash is the Holy Spirit, which is the Comforter. Double honors the apostles and elders of Great Millstone for leading by example in these last days. And Shalawam to the hopeful elect, all you Akim making your bodies a living sacrifice. Now, through the Spirit, the name of this lesson is Terrible Majesty. And I just want to go into how the power that we serve, the God of Israel, whose name is Yahawah, he is, he to be, he exists. He's a terrible majesty. Let me read this again. This is Job chapter 37, verse 22. Fair weather cometh out of the north, with the Most High is terrible majesty. And this word majesty means a royal power and excellence. Let me get the etymology. This is circa 1300. Majesty, greatness of grandeur, of exalted rank or character, imposing loftiness, stateliness, qualities appropriate to rulership, from the Latin, majestatem, greatness, dignity, elevation, honor, excellence. And the Most High is of a terrible excellence. When you put those two words together, terrible and majesty, you get a glimpse, a semblance of the power that we serve, the God of Israel. Again, Yahawah, Yah meaning he, Hawah meaning to be or exist. He is. He is terrible. He is royal. He is to be praised. He is to be loved. He's everything, man. Anything you can imagine, and more importantly, everything that you can imagine, that's what embodies the Heavenly Father. And he's known by his judgments. You have a lot of people that don't fear the Most High. They don't understand that he's a terrible majesty, but they're about to very soon. When you see mass death, when you see the day of the Lord, these people are going to know that it comes from a higher power. And if they've come across the prophets, they're going to know that a prophet had been among them. This is the book of Psalms, chapter 47, verse 2. For Yahawah, the Most High, is terrible. He is a great king over all the earth. Now, when you look in the scriptures, you see the word terrible, dreadful. These are words describing the Heavenly Father. But when you go into these doctrines of men, when you go into these religions, they try to convince you that the Most High is all loving. He's all caring. He's this white teddy bear. He's going to hug everybody. That's not in the scriptures at all. The Most High is described as a terrible and great king. This is why scripture tells you that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of his love. When you type in fear of the Lord in any Bible search, you're going to come across all kinds of precepts. Why? Because fearing someone means that you acknowledge the power that they have. You acknowledge that they have the ability to destroy you, to destroy your family, to destroy the earth. Whatever he pleases, he can do. The power is in his hands, and you have to understand that in order to fear him. And you have to have faith, ultimately, because we're in a time with a lot of false gods, a lot of false idols, a lot of people trying to take the credit from the God of Israel, saying they did this, and, well, this really happened because of an explosion trillions of years ago, and this is the result of it. Just all total manner of nonsense and ultimately disrespect against a terrible majesty. While I'm in Psalms, let me get this. This is the book of Psalms, chapter 65, verse 5. By terrible things in righteousness wilt thou answer us, O power of our salvation, who art the confidence of all the ends of the earth and of them that are afar off upon the sea, which by his strength setteth fast the mountains, being girded with power, which stilleth the noise of the seas, the noise of their waves, and the tumult of the people. Now, normally when you read the scriptures, the word mountains represents governments. Hills represent smaller governments. But this is literal. It says the Most High, by his strength, set it fast the mountains. He literally created mountains, man. The Most High created. If you ever stood next to a mountain, you understand how insignificant you are. That's why the Lord refers to us as worms, as grasshoppers. We're tiny, man. When you look next to a mountain, regardless of whatever your opinion is of yourself, how great you are, how cool you are, how tall you are, how much of a, whatever you think of yourself, standing next to a mountain, you realize just how low, how powerless you are next to the elements. The Most High actually made mountains, which geology in and of itself proves the Bible is accurate. It proves that the flood took place, but that's another lesson. The point is, the Lord created mountains. And we're his sons. We descend directly from the Most High, from the Heavenly Father. That's what the word Israel means. Israel in the Hebrew is Yasharala, Yah meaning he, Shar meaning prince, Allah meaning God or power. We're the sons of the Most High. We're the sons of a power that creates mountains, that creates seas, that holds the sea back from the... Let me get that in Jeremiah. Got to get that. This is the book of Jeremiah chapter 5. Let me start at 21. Hear now this, O foolish people, and without understanding. Right, only a fool says in his heart that there is no power, there is no Most High, there is no God. Only a foolish person would come up against the creator of heaven and earth. It says, which have eyes and see not, which have ears and hear not. Fear ye not me, saith Yahawah? Will ye not tremble at my presence, which have placed the sand for the bound of the sea by a perpetual decree that it cannot pass? And though the waves thereof toss themselves, yet can they not prevail. Though they roar, yet can they not pass over it. So, man, the Most High created the ocean and he created the sands and he set a decree. Like, look, the ocean is not going to come past this point. That's a power that you can't fathom. There's no way to wrap your mind around that. Esau has his pseudoscience where he tries to explain the natural phenomena, which he butchers constantly. The scripture tells you that we hardly guess aright on things on the earth. So how much more things in the heavens? We're dealing with a power that created the oceans and then set a decree in the sand. Like, look, there's a point that you can't pass. I want land to be right here. I want the vegetation to be right here. I want my chosen people to live on this part of the earth. And I want the fishes of the sea to live in this part right here. I'm going to have salt water over here. I'm going to have fresh water right here. I'm not going to allow them to touch each other, even when they're right next to one another. You can't wrap your mind around that, man. This is a power that we serve and we descend directly from the Most High. We're his sons. Our spirits were created before our bodies. We've been here before. We're going to be here again. Our spirits go back to the Most High, to the creator of heaven and earth. And we're his sons, man. So when you look at the heathen trying to tell us that our power doesn't exist, that all of this is a result of an explosion, all of this is a random occurrence, this is how you know that they're bastards. They're not sons of the Most High. Yes, he did create them, but he doesn't claim them. He put his name on Israel. And he gave his word to Israel. He show up us his statutes and his judgments. He have not dealt so with any nation. And that starts with Yahawashi, which is his word. Yahawashi is the living embodiment of wisdom. The Most High is so powerful. He created a being that's a God. He's a God that created a God. Let that sink in. The Most High is so powerful. He created a God that has wisdom beyond anyone's imagination. Esau has something called artificial intelligence. When I say Esau, Esau is the progenitor of the Edomites, the so-called white race. In the Bible, they're known as Edomites. They go back to a man named Esau. But anyway, Esau has something called artificial intelligence. And right now, it's already surpassed him. This man is so stupid. He created an intelligence that's smarter than he is. How do you create something that can outsmart you and destroy you? How do you create your own destruction? That just showing you how stupid this man. Look, the so-called white man is not God. All right. He's a base man. He's a troglodyte. He's a cave dweller. But the Most High is so powerful. He didn't just create artificial intelligence. He created real intelligence and wisdom. And he gave it to his sons. And he's so powerful that even all of his creations, as smart as they are, as wise as they are, they're still nothing compared to his intelligence. That's how far beyond he is. He's so powerful, he can create an actual God, actual deities, actual angels, and they can do nothing but tremble before him. The scripture tells you one angel is strong enough to wipe out the entire planet Earth. One angel. And he's created armies and hosts of angels, man. He's more powerful than all of them put together. That's the power we serve, a terrible majesty, which again, that word majesty means royal power. Who's more royal than Yahawah, bahasham, Yahawashi? Who's more powerful? This is the book of Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 17. For Yahawah, your power, is a God of gods and Lord of lords, a great power, a mighty and a terrible power, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. Right? When you look at every idol on earth, all these idols exist to appease the egos of men, to appease people in their vain imaginations. All right, I'm going to worship Jesus the Christ, and he's going to forgive me of all this wickedness I do, even though I don't repent, even though I don't even care about the scriptures, but I call on the name Jesus, and shamalamalamala, everything's going to be okay. That's a vain, idiotic idol, okay? Allah. You worship a God that's telling you to fly to Mecca and pay some Arabs for you to walk around a stone. You worship a God that doesn't even have a name. Yo, I'm Allah. My name is Allah. What the hell is that? The word Allah is a Hebrew word that means God or power. You worship a God named God. That's vanity. That's an idol. All of this stuff is made up. And when you go into it, the people that follow these idols, they're really worshiping themselves. They're worshiping their own righteousness. Because when you come into the discipline of the scriptures, you become a disciple. That's where that word comes from. The discipline required to keep the law, statutes, and commandments of the Heavenly Father, which the word statute means limitation or boundary. You have boundaries in the truth. These idols just tell you, look, as long as you believe in me, as long as you sacrifice to me, everything's going to be okay. No, everything's not going to be okay. We've given up our lives to serve Yahawah Bahasham Yahawashi every day, and we don't even know if we're going to make it. That's how terrible His Majesty is. You can sacrifice everything for this deity, and it's still within His power to completely destroy you with the snap of a finger. Not even a snap, just a thought. You could be nothing, man. So this is the type of fear that you need to have. And notice it says, which regardeth not persons. The Most High is not a respecter of persons. For an example, just look at the flood. The Most High killed everyone on earth except 8 people. And He didn't kill them by, you know, just allowing them to die in their sleep, or they have a heart attack, or they get shot in the back of the head. No, He drowned. He drowned everyone on earth except 8 people. You have any idea how horrible it is to drown to death? He drowned children. He drowned pregnant women. He drowned babies. This man is a straight savage. Imagine standing on the edge of a pool and you see a pool full of children drowning. They're various ages, 3 years old, 5 years old, 7 years old, 6 months old. You just see a pool full of children and you watch them drown to death. And you don't jump in. You don't try to help them. You don't call for help. You just stand there with a mean mug, a total ice grill. No emotion in your face whatsoever. You don't blink. You just sit and watch children drown to death. That's the power that we serve. That's the power of a terrible majesty. He doesn't respect persons. He looks at the spirit of a person. He knows, okay, this child went off and he's being judged right now. He's not looking at it as, okay, this is little Jamal. This is little Timothy. This is little... No. He's looking at the spirit. This is a wicked soul that committed wickedness in a previous incarnation. He came back down and now he's being judged. It doesn't matter that he's 3 years old. It doesn't matter that he's 7. It doesn't matter that he's 6 months. None of that matters. We're dealing with a power that has no respect of persons. But niggas want to play games. Who wrote the Bible? How do you know this? How do you know? Hey, you're going to find out the hard way who wrote the Bible. This is back in the book of Psalms, chapter 66, verse 3. Say unto the Most High, how terrible art thou in thy works? How terrible art thou in thy works? Through the greatness of thy power shall thine enemies submit themselves unto thee, right? Through the greatness of his power. That's how these enemies, when you go into Psalms 83, it describes the nations as the enemies of the Heavenly Father. It says, thine enemies make a tumult against you and your people. These enemies of the Most High, they're going to learn respect when he judges this place, when he judges Babylon the Great. All of these heathen are going to know. Let me keep reading. Verse 4, all the earth shall worship thee and shall sing unto thee. They shall sing to thy name, Selah. And Selah is like an ad lib. These are songs when you go into it. Selah is like a pause or an ad lib at the end of a hot bar. It says, all the earth shall worship thee and shall sing unto thee. They shall sing to thy name, Selah. Come and see the works of the Most High. He is terrible. He is terrible in his doing toward the children of men. He turned the sea into dry land. They went through the flood on foot. There did we rejoice in him. He ruleth by his power forever. His eyes behold the nations. Let not the rebellious exalt themselves. Selah. So this is talking about the first deliverance, the first Exodus, when the Most High judged Egypt for enslaving his chosen people. And it tells you in Jeremiah repeatedly that there's going to be another deliverance that's going to completely eclipse the deliverance out of Egypt. We're going to be delivered in such a fashion that we're not even going to celebrate the old Passover anymore. There's going to be a new Passover to commemorate the deliverance of the 12 tribes out of Babylon the Great and the destruction of this whore, this filthy, defiled, decrepit system. It's going to be completely wiped off the face of the earth, and we're going to rejoice, and all of these heathen are going to fear. The same way when we came out of Egypt, the heathen heard about the name Yahawah. This time they're going to hear Yahawah Bahasham Yahawashi. They're going to see Yahawashi, and they're going to fear. Let me get this real quick. This is the book of Joshua, chapter 9, verse 7. And the men of Israel said unto the Hivites, peradventure ye dwell among us, and how shall we make a league with you? And they said unto Joshua, we are thy servants. We are thy servants. And Joshua said unto them, who are you? And from whence come you? And they said unto him, from a very far country thy servants are come, because of the name of Yahawah thy power. For we have heard of the fame of him and all that he did in Egypt. So these heathen were ready to serve the Israelites because of what they heard about our power and what our power did to our enemies, the Egyptians. And that's going to happen again. The scripture tells you there's no new thing under the sun. The thing that have been is now. And right now we're in a time where the Lord is about to deliver the 12 tribes by completely eradicating Babylon. So all of the heathen round about, what is that going to do to them? They're going to fear the name Yahawah, bahasham, Yahawashi. They're going to fear our terrible majesty. They're going to see the destruction of Babylon the Great, and they're actually going to bring our sons and daughters to Jerusalem. It tells you in prophecy, they're going to carry our daughters back to our homeland. What's going to make them do that? A terrible majesty, seeing the destruction, seeing the judgment that comes with putting your hands on the apple of the eye of Yahawah, bahasham, Yahawashi. Now, this is Jeremiah chapter 20, verse 11. But Yahawah is with me as a mighty, terrible one. Therefore, my persecutors shall stumble, and they shall not prevail. They shall be greatly ashamed, for they shall not prosper. Right? No weapon formed against us shall prosper. These Edomites have all these grand ideas about shoving things up our nostrils, shoving things in our hands. This man is a total pervert, but he's not going to win. When he thinks he's about to fulfill his enterprise, the Most High is going to cast him down. It says, their everlasting confusion shall never be forgotten. But O Yahawah, the Lord of hosts, that treats the righteousness and sees the reins and the heart, let me see thy vengeance on them, for unto thee have I opened my cause. Sing unto Yahawah, praise ye Yahawah, for he hath delivered the soul of the poor from the hand of the evildoers. And that's the power we serve. We serve a power of mercy and deliverance. And he's going to remember us, man. It tells you in the gospel according to Luke 1 and 68 that he's remembered the covenant to our forefathers, that he would deliver us from the hand of our enemies. That's what salvation is, to be delivered from the heathen, not with the heathen. That's a whole nother gospel that Christianity is dealing with. It has nothing to do with the scriptures. The scriptures talk about the God of Israel delivering Israel from the enemies of Israel. That's it. That's the movie. Spoiler alert. The heathen are going to be destroyed. Then they're going to be enslaved. That's the bottom line, man. That's the narrative of the scriptures. So you knowing that, you're supposed to fear Yahawah, bahasham, Yahawashi, because you could easily end up like one of these two-thirds that are going to receive the judgment of the heathen. They're going to be destroyed in Babylon the Great, right next to the Edomites, right next to the Ishmaelites, the Moabites, all of these heathen that are round about us. Those of our people that don't repent and take heed to this word, they're going to be destroyed as a heathen. They're going to be in the kingdom of heaven knowing that they're from a power of mercy and judgment and justice and righteousness. And they forsook that to live in temporary comfort with the heathen. So let me end with this. This is the book of Sirach, chapter 43, verse 29. Yahawah is terrible and very great, and marvelous is his power. Right. The Most High's power is marvelous. People marvel at inventions of men. People marvel at so-called technology that Esau comes up with. People marvel at so-called great inventions. But every single one of those inventions is based on something that the Most High already created. A plane is inferior to a bird. When you look at the technology that goes into creating a bird, an eagle, a falcon, the Most High is way ahead of Esau. Anything you can name, a camera, 4K, super high definition. Do you not know that the eye is more advanced than any camera that Esau has ever created? But a lot of our people would rather worship something that they can see, something that they could put their hands on, something that's tangible, because they don't have faith. They can't worship the unseen. The Most High is a power that hides himself, so you need faith in order to believe in him. And without faith, it's impossible to please him, which is another lesson I may do in the near future. But Abaratzadis was edifying. I want to give all praises, honor, and glory to Yahawah, Bahashem Yahawashi, Bahashem Rahakwadash, double honors to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone, and Shalawam to the hopeful elect.